Dear colleague, welcome to this course in visual identification of electrode location. We have in the previous courses discussed targeting and how to perform calculation of coordinates. In the present course, we will discuss how to verify that the electrode is actually placed in the intended target. This is a very short course based on one single self-study lecture and a few downloadable operation plans. There are different methods for visualization of the electrodes. Some use intraoperative fluoroscopy, but fluoroscopic confirmation using a crosshair kit during the implantation will only provide information about the relation to the Z and the Y coordinates, and this does not sufficient. Concerning the O arm, this will be dealt with in a coming lecture. However, concerning the current lecture, the O arm can be considered equivalent to CT. CT and MRI can be used in various ways. The investigation can be done stereotactically during surgery if you have a MRI, CT or O arm in the OR, and this is of course the best solution. The second best option is to perform a stereotactic investigation after electrode implantation and thereafter continue with the IPG implantation. A third option is to make the whole implantation in one session and then to perform a stereotactic investigation before removing the frame. This is not a bad method if you seldom have to correct the electrode position. To perform a non-stereotactic CT or MRI sometime after the procedure is of course better than nothing. This might be sufficient if you have performed intraoperative testing and you're happy with the result. If you do not perform intraoperative evaluation of the effect, this is acceptable only if you have an excellent record regarding accuracy in electrode placement and if you virtually never make mistakes. When we calculate the location of the electrode, it is of course necessary to know the technical specifications of the electrodes which you are using. I am using conventional LEDs from Medtronic, where the tip of the LED is 1.5 mm and the length of the contact 1.5 mm and, depending on the model, separated by 0.5 or 1.5 mm. I am also using the new directional leads from Abbott. Here the tip of the LED is only 1 mm and the contact length 1.5 mm with the same distance as mentioned regarding the Medtronic electrode. Concerning these directional leads, the two middle contacts of the directional lead are divided into three individual segments. Above the contacts is a directional marker. During implantation, the electrode is implanted with the directional marker facing forwards. The location of this marker, and hence the location of the individual segments, can be deduced from an O-arm or a plane X-ray in two projections. The location of the directional marker cannot be decided from an MRI and most often not from a CT. Hence, the exact orientation of the segments cannot be decided with the technique described here, but directional leads will be discussed in detail in other chapters. Concerning the angle of implantation, one should remember that the double oblique trajectory of the electrode has a certain effect on how many millimeters along the set axis that the electrode will cover. See the two authentic examples in the table here. Just to give one example, with the deepest contact in the target in the zona incerta at 4 mm below the ICL, an electrode with 0.5 mm between the contacts will have one contact in the VIM, and an electrode with 1.5 mm will have two contacts in the VIM. Remember also that the angulation of the electrode and the CT MRI scan sections will affect the geometrical representation of the electrode in the images. So the electrode artifact on the axial CT MRI will not be a circle but an ellipse. Concerning postoperative CT, I prefer to use this for identification of the electrode location, mainly because it is faster and because it is easier to decide the depth of the electrode. As you see in the images here, the contacts themselves can be identified on the CT since the artifact is larger over them. The size of the artifact is dependent on your attenuation setting, so measure the diameter of the artifact in order to understand how it is related to the real diameter of the electrode. Normally, I do not identify the individual contacts from the artifacts on the CT. I identify the tip of the electrode and calculate the location of the contacts based on their distance from the tip. A CT covering the whole skull is done and fused with the preoperative MRI in the navigation system. The window of the CT is then changed until only the electrode is seen. The CT is blended with the preoperative MRI on which the target was identified. You can now look directly at the electrode's relation to the intended target. Here we have one example in the GPI. Here we see the scans from 4 mm below the ACPC level to 5 mm above. Another example in the subthalamic nucleus. An example in the caudal zona incerta. And finally, one example in the bed nucleus of stria terminalis, an internal capsule. Sometimes it's not sufficient to see where the electrode ended up. You will also want to calculate the exact location of the electrode. In order to do this, we create a new track in the navigation system. We put the entry of the trajectory in the center of the electrode, about 25 mm above the old target. Do not put the entry at the beginning of the electrode, since not all electrodes are straight. Then put your new target at the tip of the electrode. Use all three projections when doing this, as well as the probe's eye view. You will need to play a little with the window when you're identifying the tip of the electrode. If you reduce the signal too much, you will take away the plastic tip and only see the distal end of the deepest contact. You can now identify each contact based on its distance from the tip of the electrode. This will of course vary with the electrode model. You can move along the trajectory and make minor adjustments by changing the coordinates, but try to stay in the plan and reasonably well centered in the electrode. In this example, we have followed the trajectory 2.25 mm from the tip of the electrode. This is the center of the deepest contact in this electrode model. The coordinates are here displayed for this point. We can now continue in the same manner with the other contacts. We can now also calculate the difference in intended and actual location of the electrode. For scientific reasons, this might be of value. And you might want to calculate the deviation from the intended target in all planes as well as the vectorial sum. This is easily done by comparing the coordinates of the intended target with the coordinates for the contact intended to be placed in the intended target, as described above. However, for clinical purposes, I find the following method to be sufficient. First, we go to the intended target in the planning system. Now, move your cursor to the center of the electrode on the axial image. You can now see the vectorial deviation for the Y and the X, and you can compare the individual coordinates with the intended target in these planes. And this will be discussed further in the course and lecture on improving accuracy. Concerning MRI, you can use the same method as described above. The only advantage with using MRI is that the fusion error is probably smaller than when fusing a CT and an MRI. There are a few points of importance. We will here continue to look at the same patient as described above regarding CT. In the image here, we see an intraoperative MRI with the cursor in the intended target. When we use the same window as in the preoperative MRI, the electrode artifact is so large that you do not see much. In this image, we have made an attempt to optimize the visualization of the target area and the electrode, but it's not much better. The cursor is still placed in the center of the electrode artifact. The image is now optimized with regard to the electrode artifact and the cursor placed in the center of this. It is now possible to switch to the preoperative MRI and decide on the location of the electrode from the position of the cursor. In this manner, it is easy to get a good understanding of the location of your electrode in relation to the target. Calculations on MRI are done as described for CT. Personally, I find it somewhat difficult to decide on the location of the tip of the electrode, since the artifact is often considerably deeper. It is often helpful not to focus too much on the axial image, but to look at the shape of the electrode on the sagittal and especially on the coronal images. To the right, we see the cursor at the tip of the electrode in the postoperative T2. Here we have a T1 with the cursor at the same point. However, as we see from the cursor here on the T2, it will be quite easy to believe that the tip is located 1 mm further down. This is also the case when we look at the T1. If you look mainly at the axial images, you might even believe that it is 2 mm further down, as seen here. As described above regarding CT, it is also possible to identify the contacts from the enlarged artifact around these. These artifacts are, however, mainly visible on coronal investigations. They are of limited help in the reconstructed images used in a navigation system. In conclusion, when deciding the depth from an MRI, be careful and take your time. Concerning MRI, I would also like to mention that it has sometimes been stated that identifying the position of an electrode from a postoperative MRI is like spearfishing due to MRI distortion and water refraction. This is a false analogy. MRI distortion can affect the apparent position of the target area, and water refraction will do the same with the fish. However, when the electrode or spear enters the target, it will be affected by the same distortion and refraction as the target. When the spear appears to be in the fish, it is actually in the fish, as everyone who has spearfished knows, and the same is true regarding the electrode. This course contains some exercises. A number of cases for practice of electrode identification are available for download into your own navigation system. Each case is accompanied by a downloadable case guide. I suggest that you upload the stealth operation plans for patients 1, 2 and 3. Look at my suggestions regarding the ACPC. Would you have defined them in the same way? Then identify the deepest contact bilaterally in patients 1 to 3. After each patient, when you have finished, Compare these with my suggestions. Look also at the relationship between contact zero and my suggested target. Look at my suggested trajectories. Would you have chosen the same? Then continue by identifying the remaining contacts in these patients. And with this, I end this presentation. Thank you for your attention.